And I always think of Easter morning with Mary coming to the tomb and finding it empty, and then encountering Jesus in the form of a gardener. So these pieces kind of set that mood, I think. And I'm going to start with Eric Satie's second Gymnopédie, and then I'm going to move into a setting of In the Garden, I Come to the Garden Alone, and that's by Dale Wood. And then I have a kind of a medley of Easter hymns written by Mark Hayes, Crown Him with Many Crowns, Look Ye Saints, The Sight is Glorious, and Thine is the Glory by Handel. So first, this Gymnopédie number two of Eric Satie.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning and a very blessed Easter to you. The words of Psalm 118 call our attention to worship. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is great, and steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, God's steadfast love endures forever. For the Lord is my strength and my might. God has become my salvation. There are glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of our God, and the righteous shall enter through it. And I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is our God's own doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. For this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Friends, welcome. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Come, let us join our voices from the comfort of our own homes as Cynthia and Faye lead us in our opening hymn.
Amen. Please join me for the Easter Collect, which is now in your chat room. God of glory, in the rising of Jesus Christ, you have shattered death's grip and set us on a path to freedom. We rejoice in the promise of this new day. Fill our souls with love and hope. Strengthen us for works of justice and mercy. Teach us to live as a resurrected and resurrecting people, open to the promise of each new dawn through Jesus Christ. Amen. And now let us pass the peace in whichever way we can feel comfortable in this new way of being in community by saying, Alleluia, Christ is risen. Alleluia, Christ is risen indeed. the peace of God be with you, and also with you.
I mean, I hope we don't.
Hey everyone, we're having just a quick tech glitch. We're going to get Cynthia unmuted and we will continue on with the music in 1 second. Thanks for your patience, everyone.
Sam, should we do it again?
Yes, please start again. We're ready when you are. Sounds beautiful. Thank you, Cynthia and Faye. And thank you everyone for your patience, because digital church requires a new language for all of us. So now is the moment for the children and young people to take your place center stage, right in the middle of the camera screen. I want to see everybody's hands waving. Good morning, everybody. Now is the time for the children's moment. So some of you have eggs, and if you have an egg that you drew or a chocolate egg that you're considering eating, now is the moment to show it on the screen. Now is the moment where we are going to offer the blessing of a chocolate egg or an art egg, whatever you've got, show it off so everybody can see it. Awesome. Those look very, very cool. You all are amazing artists. So for Easter today, you have offered a blessing of eggs, and you can see if you tab through and look at some of the other cameras that there are eggs hidden around the frame in certain people's viewfinders in their camera. And you will find after service, there are even more eggs to find. So just a little preview of what's yet to come. But for now, let's sit, let's take a breath in together. Breathe out and let's pray. God, we thank you for Easter. We thank you that Christ is risen. We thank you for all of the joy that is yet to come, that is revealed today, for spring flowers, for all the warmth and the good that we're going to do in the lives of others, and all of the blessings that are given to us. We thank you, God, that Easter means that we do not have to hide in closets. We do not have to live in tombs, that good is coming in the world. So we honor that in how we live on Easter Sunday. Thank you for all of the blessings. Thank you for all the ways you bless us and teach us how to bless others. Let's all say together, Amen. And let's pray together this special prayer, the Lord's Prayer that Jesus taught his friends a long time ago, because they didn't know how to pray, so they asked Jesus. And he taught them how to pray using these special words. So let's say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy will be done, thy kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, for thine is the kingdom and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Join me for the prayer of preparations. Let the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. The first scripture for today is from Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 1 through 6. At this time, says the Lord, I will be the God of all the families of Israel, and they shall be my people. Thus says the Lord, the people who survived the sword found grace in the wilderness. When Israel sought for rest, the Lord appeared to him from far away. I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, I have continued my faithfulness to you. Again, I will build you, and you shall be built, O virgin Israel. Again, you shall take your tambourines and go forth in the dance of the merrymakers. Again, you shall plant vineyards on the mountains of Samaria. The planters shall plant and shall enjoy the fruit. For there shall be a day when sentinels will call in the hill country of Ephraim, come, let us go up to Zion, to the Lord our God. The second scripture for today is from John chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down and looked in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet, they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said to them, they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? For whom are you looking? Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned and said to him in Hebrew, Rabbani, which means teacher. Jesus said to her, do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, I have seen the Lord. And she told them that he had said these things to her. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, while the city still slept, the roads eerily quiet, Mary Magdalene slipped out of her bed. Between yesterday's Sabbath and with Friday's death still lingering, her house was feeling a little small. She needed to get out. She didn't make a sound. And with quiet determination, she knew what she was going to do. She gathered the spices and the oils and the herbs into a bag. She quietly unlatched the door and went out to those deserted streets. She was going to anoint the body of one she loved, of one she had watched die. She had been with him when he died, but as it was the day of preparation, his body was taken from her that day and laid in a new tomb owned by another friend. And so early on Sunday morning, when the world still slept, she wakes. In truth, she probably hadn't been sleeping much anyway. And she goes to the tomb, which was in a garden, before sunrise, to say goodbye. Did any of you see the sunrise this morning? Who among us greeted the sun this Easter morning like Mary did with our own mourning or questions or wanting to do something? Who among us felt the call of a new dawn, a new day? And which of us will respond and how? When Mary gets to the tomb, she sees that the stone guarding its entrance has been rolled away. Immediately filled with what must have been a combination of fear and anger, frustration, indignation, and grief, she turns and runs. She doesn't even look in. She just runs. With the stone rolled away, all she can think is that she is yet again robbed of a chance to say goodbye. Who could do this to her? How could they? She finds Peter and the beloved disciple, who, like her, probably hadn't been sleeping very well anyway. And together the three run back to the tomb. Jesus's beloved disciple gets there first. Of course he does. Peter arrives breathless just after and goes straight into the tomb, where he finds no body, just neatly folded linen cloths. The beloved disciple looks in then as well, and seeing, scripture tells us, he believed. And with that, the two men leave the tomb. They go home. This is one of the things the disciples are often doing. They just leave. They never quite get it. They don't stay for the best part of the story. They walk right past Mary. Mary, who stays outside the tomb, she's standing there, sobbing, crying her eyes out. What a strange world this has become. Would anything ever be the same? What is this new way? Where is everybody? Could we start again, please? Mary had been the first to respond, the first one there. And now she would be the last one out. Mary wouldn't desert him. She'd never leave him. Bending to look into the tomb once more, she now sees two angels in white, who ask her the improbable question of why does she weep? Why am I weeping? Who are you? Do you not know what's going on? The better question Mary could have asked is, why aren't you weeping? Can't you see death is all around us? And you ask why I am weeping? She doesn't say all of this, or if she does, it's not recorded. But you know it's there. You know it's here. And when she explains that she weeps because someone has taken away her Lord, She turns, and there's Jesus. She doesn't recognize him at first, tears in her eyes and all. She doesn't recognize him until he says her name. Psychologists tell us that there is no sound more important for each of us to hear than our own names. Among the first sounds an infant comes to recognize, a word each of us love to hear when spoken by people we love, a mark of our personhood and of our relationships. Mary, Jesus says, and she knows it's him. And after the briefest of conversations, she leaves the tomb and she goes to tell the disciples of all what she alone has seen. First responder, first respondent, Mary, both nurse and reporter. John's telling of this Easter story is in many ways a more personal, more human than the other gospel accounts. Matthew's telling is far more triumphant and grander, the kind of Easter we typically like with timpani and brass. In Matthew, when Mary, who went with the other Mary, arrived at the tomb, there was suddenly a great earthquake, and an angel descends and rolls away the stone right in front of their very eyes. And then he perches upon that same stone. And in Matthew, we hear the familiar words, "He is not here, for he has been raised." Magisterial and majestic Matthew, Matthew that has inspired cathedrals and Easter worship across the world, across the centuries. Mark's telling is quick and to the point, perfect for sunrise services we might have missed this morning. And it includes a young man robed in white who was sitting in the tomb waiting for the women to arrive. And he tells them, "You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here." Straightforward, to the point. That's Mark to the end. And in Luke, like Mark and John, has the stone already rolled away when the women arrive. And when the women go in, two men in dazzling white clothes arrive. And as the women tremble in fear, the angels say again the familiar, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen." The three synoptic gospels all give us the familiar Easter refrain, "He is risen," each of them proclaim. "Christ is risen indeed," we all respond. But John gives us no such proclamation. Rather, here in John, there is a statement of faith that John gives us something more like caution. "Don't touch me," Jesus says. "Don't touch me, Mary, because I have not yet ascended to my God and your God." Jesus is alive and speaking to someone who watched him die, and yet he has not yet ascended. This is the mystery of faith that is in John. In John, Easter is continuing revelation. It's part of the story, but it's not the end of the story. And I have to admit that in ordinary times, I lean a little more toward Matthew for Easter Sunday. I like good church. I like the brass and the organ with all the stops pulled out. I want Deb singing from our pulpit. I want our choir. I want a big packed church crammed with people, lilies, and over-sugared children making joyful noise. That's the Easter I want. That's the Easter I look forward to year after year. It's the Easter I thought I was mourning. But that's not the Easter we have this year, friends. And it's not the Easter of John's gospel. This Easter, John's Easter, our Easter, is personal. We gather only with those closest to us, the ones with whom we have now been gathered for many weeks. Some of us are weeping. Some of us, like Mary, are first responders who put your own safety on the line to care for the sick and the dying and the dead. Some of us are like the disciples, alternating between adrenaline spikes and crashes. I venture to say that all of us know what it feels like to have something or someone taken away, and the confusion and the anguish of such strange times. In the midst of all of this, the tomb that Mary found is still empty. Our church, which we love, also sits empty. Churches of the faithful all over the world today sit empty. This is not the Easter any of us would have imagined. But how faithful it is. Our churches sit empty as a witness to the empty tomb. He is not there. He is not here. He is not there. The promise of this Easter is that Christ cannot be contained in a tomb or in a church or anything we humans can fashion. The tomb is empty because we proclaim life, a life that Christ has given and promised, a life that will be abundant and sure. The Gospel of John tells of resurrection that will come in the morning, even when ascension hasn't yet happened, even when we're not yet out of the woods. This is our day. Resurrection is true and assured. God will guide us out of death and into new life. For God has done it before, and God will do it again and again and again. This is the resurrection of Jesus Christ, a day for all of us to witness that what is empty is not lost, but is life. This is a quieter Easter. We'll pull out all the stops in person some other time soon. But know that in this time, this Easter, Christ has come to you in the most intimate of ways, calling your name and telling the promises of God. For I have come to each of you to give you life and life abundant. Christ is not in an empty tomb, nor in an empty church. Christ is risen and lives with each of you. Wherever you are, wherever you go, Christ is alive. Alleluia and amen.
The Lord is come again, like Good morning, and welcome to West End Church. All week I've been thinking that if ever there was a time we needed the hope of Easter, the glory of resurrection, this is it. But like Will, I also wondered if we could pull off Easter with the world outside still sitting squarely in Good Friday. Could we pull off Easter without a sanctuary teeming with lilies and the triumphant sound of a brass ensemble? Could we pull off Easter without Deb Monk and her glorious voice calling us to worship? Yet as I scrolled through each of your faces this morning, it occurred to me that we just might be Mary Magdalene at the empty tomb, or their disciples walking along the road to Emmaus with the resurrected Jesus, not yet recognizing, not yet comprehending who stood before them. We are here. We are together doing a new thing. We are getting to know one another more intimately in spite of our physical separation. We are praying together each morning. We are building a stronger community seeking Christ. Today, as I look at each one of your faces, I see the glory of resurrection. Thank you for being here. If you are visiting today, we are so glad you have chosen to join us. Whoever you are, wherever you are from, wherever you are on life's journey, whatever you doubt or believe, whoever you love, you are welcome here. We hope you have a few moments to linger after service today. In addition to virtual coffee hour, as Pastor Sam mentioned earlier, we will be hosting the first ever West End virtual Easter egg hunt. Please stick around if you want to enjoy some fellowship and conversation and a little bit of Easter shenanigans. Tomorrow morning at 9 a.m., we continue our now regular schedule of online spiritual formation and community with weekday morning prayer with Pastor Will. If you have 15 minutes and would like to start your day with psalm reading and reflection, I really encourage you to join. It has become a grounding daily practice for me in this time when so much is uncertain. Our offerings continue on Wednesday with Spirit Talk at noon, and Taze, our midweek contemplative service of music and poetry at 6:30 p.m. And on Friday evenings, any stir-crazy kids or teens are invited to join Pastor Sam for virtual kids club and youth group. More information about each of these offerings, as well as Sunday morning adult education and children's church school, and other specialized weekly programming such as book club and writer's circle, is available on the events page at westendchurch.org. West End Church is indeed alive, my friends. We are a praying community here at West End, and we will lift our prayers together a bit later in service. If there is something tender on your heart, or words of gratitude or thanksgiving you would like to share, you can begin entering them in the chat box now. If you are a visitor and would like to be added to our email list, please send an email to pastors@westendchurch.org. We've now reached the point in our service where we offer our gifts in furtherance of all the good work God is doing both here and through West End. Virtual contributions can be made using the link in the chat box. If you typically mail your pledges, don't worry, you can keep doing that. We are still receiving them in the office. We are grateful for your generosity, and we are grateful that you chose to worship with us today. Happy Easter. Thank you.
All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. Amen. Friends, will you join with me in prayer? God of new beginnings, the heavens proclaim your goodness, the earth springs forth to share in your resurrection. You have promised to be with us always, even to the end of the age, and truly, you are a God who keeps your promises. For us and for our salvation, you took on human flesh. You walked and talked and ate and hurt among us. In your living, you taught us the better path. In your dying, you showed us that we have nothing to fear. For in you, all is made new again. Resurrection is real and assured. Alleluia. O God, this day is not like other Easter days. Come to us and listen to us as we pray. For we pray for all who are suffering, especially those who suffer from or with or alongside COVID-19. We pray for healthcare workers and first responders. We pray for the dead, trusting that they live in you and in our hearts. We pray the concerns of this church community. Some of the prayers that have been offered include prayers from Judith for health and safety, for medical and police and delivery and grocery and pharmacy workers. A prayer from Karen of thanksgiving that her friend Jessie is recovering from cancer. We pray with Elizabeth for her brother Stuart, who is hospitalized in New Mexico. A prayer from Deborah for Nick, who is on a ventilator, and his wife Amanda and their baby Elvis. A prayer from Stephanie Shelley for her uncle John, who passed away yesterday, most likely of COVID-19. A prayer of thanksgiving from Priscilla that Beth Links is slowly but steadily healing. A prayer from Julia for a friend Norman, who died last week after a long and often painful decline. His wife is alone. May God come and comfort her. A prayer from Delphi for Charles and Whitney, both of whom are doctors, doing what they were so expertly trained to do and sacrificing everything to save lives. A prayer from Nina for elderly family members, for their safety and good spirits. A prayer from Pat of thanksgiving that Tim Mathis has almost fully recovered. He's staying at home under doctor's care, and blessings to all who have this virus. A prayer from Lynn and Ned of thanksgiving for being here today. And from Lynn, how good it is to see all of her old West End friends. A prayer for Keith and his family as they mourn the loss of a dear aunt and a cousin who passed away this week. A prayer from Catherine and Peter, who offer thanks for the blessing of being together with wonderful old and dear friends. And for our son Andrew, who is distant from us this year. A prayer from Andrea, who is grateful for the West End ministry team, for Bridget and Sam and Cynthia, for all they have done to push us and to feed us this Holy Week. A prayer from Michael Hayek for the family and friends of John LaFoon, who passed away this weekend. John was the building manager at West End for many years and the father-in-law of our own Debbie. We pray for their family. A prayer from William for Carol's older parent that they may be kept safe in COVID-19. A prayer from Bob Smith in memory of an old friend, Arnold Davis, a college roommate who died a few weeks ago, and of Steve Edwards, a recent victim of COVID-19. We pray with Winnie for her friends Ivy and Brian, who recently suffered the loss of a family member due to COVID, and a prayer for all who have lost loved ones during this time. We also pray with Winnie for her dad and his colleagues who work in a hospital, and for all the healthcare workers around the world. A prayer from Jonah, O Lord, please help. Prayers from Jane, of comfort and strength for her sons JJ and Will, who are far from home. So many wonderful West End Easters and Easter egg hunts of years gone by. A prayer from Jonah for our leaders to lead and not engage in political warfare. From Andrea for her son Joe, that he is safe and healthy and knows that he is loved. A prayer from Vanessa for her mother, for protection from COVID-19. A prayer from Narvi. Thanks be to God for our church family. Please grant us peace and mercy. O God, you know the prayers of our hearts even before they are on our lips, long before they are typed into chat windows. Come to us. Incline your ear. May every day be an Easter day. May we practice resurrection in the living of each moment. For as you lift us up, help us to lift each other up, bolster our faith, stir up our conviction, foster our generosity. For us and for our sake, you have shown unbridled love. Let us put our trust in you, for all else surely fails. Resurrect us this day, Almighty God, and may we share in your glory forever and ever, world without end, life without end. Amen.
Amen. At this time, if we were all worshiping together in the sanctuary, we would dust ourselves up and step in front of the organ and grab our sheet music and begin to sing the Hallelujah Chorus with our choir. So through the incredible production of Allison and Cynthia and our choir, we have a digital equivalent available. So we are going to make this happen digitally in just 1 second, as technology is allowing us to share my screen, and share my sound. So now you should be all able to see the Hallelujah Chorus. So find your part, soprano, alto, tenor, bass, and follow along with the West End Choir singing the Hallelujah Chorus.
Hallelujah.
wow, that is a new thing. That is a new thing that God is doing in our midst. And I could hear all of you. And you know, one of the wonders about us all singing alone in our living rooms is that, like when we sing in the shower, we were all in perfect pitch. Well done. All of you sounded beautifully, and I know you were singing your hearts out. Happy Easter, friends. Don't look for God among the dead, for God has been with them. God has conquered death. God has taken the dead to new places, places of life, of love, and of hope. God will do this every day, all day long, forever and ever. God lives and lives with each of you in your homes, in your hearts, and will guard you and keep you. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Christ is with you to the end of the age. Alleluia. Amen.